Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This is Yun here again with another video tutorial. Today we're going to do some texturing, and I'm going to texture a pre-made character, and we're also going to render it and make it look really nice, kind of like the picture that you see here. Now this character you see here is called Marcos. This is a mouse character that I created a base mesh for one of my plugins. And if I just go into Maya right here, you can see this character. It's very simple, it's all rigged, everything's all ready to go. I've got my facial movements or facial controls here. Okay, and in this tutorial I want to show you how to texture a character fairly realistically, creating all the normal maps, lighting the scene to make it look great, and also giving it an appealing pose. Now if I go into this render right here, and I'm using a render called furryball. The reason why I'm using furryball is that it's just much faster for me to make points rather than for me to render it out in metal ray and, you know, spend 5-10 minutes waiting for it. With furryball I can utilize its hardware rendering techniques, and then I can show you the character very quickly. I might actually do it in this renderer right here. If you want more information about this hardware renderer, the link is on the bottom. So ideally what we want to do in our low poly model, because it is low poly, we need to drive the textures. Sorry, we need to drive this character using the textures, okay? So most of the realism is going to come from the textures. What I'm going to be showing you is how to create the diffuse and then create the normal maps. And there are a few things that you're going to need to utilize. Firstly, you need Endo2. The link is on the bottom as well. And you also need to go to cgtextures.com, because we're going to grab some textures from there and apply it into our texture or our texture map. So you can see the character here is lit fairly well. I've utilized some subsurface scattering. It is a little bit slow, but given the fact that it is actually rendering almost in real time, it's quite an achievement actually. So hardware renderer, very, very useful. All right, so in the end, though that 3D scene doesn't look great, we are going to render it out and then apply some compositing techniques to this. I'm going to be using After Effects and Photoshop. You can just use Photoshop if you want, but I'm using After Effects because with After Effects, you can also create or composite your animations in a similar way. So at the end result, we're going to get a result that looks kind of at this level in terms of quality. We've got subsurface scattering, and we're going to create some appealing backgrounds. Alright, so with that in mind, this is the texture that you see right here, and I'm just going to show you the texture map very quickly. You can see that I've applied the head in one corner of the segment right here. Got some eyes, got some sleeves, this is the torso, got some hair follicles up there as well, and we've got the jeans. So we've also got hands and feet right here. So this is how I've laid out my UV maps. I've left this bottom one free, reserved for other projects. You don't have to do it the way I do. I've just done it this way because I'm using my own personal plugin. So with that in mind, we're going to start anew. This is a similar layout, and I've created a reference PSD. And the character we're going to be texturing is a character that's based on this one, but the name of the character is Hazel. Now Hazel is a female version of the character that you see before. I have created this again with the same plugin. It allows me to generate rodent characters complete with rigs and skin weights and such. So Hazel is just the female version. We're going to texture her and make her appealing and such. And every principle I'm going to be using here is exactly the same as what I have done to create the Marcos character. So this is the UV texture map that we're going to be using. And before we begin, we need to create a color scheme for her. So I'm going to go through some basics in color theory. So color theory essentially is just the study or the science of color, how color affects mood and such. There's a lot of details you can go online. I've provided another link below for you to take a look at. But essentially what you have is we can do like a three-way, two-way, or what do you call it? Contrasting colors. I don't even know what it's called anymore. But what we're doing here, if I can just grab my brush. Okay, so what we're trying to do is one technique is a triple or a triangle method. So what happens is you select three colors on the wheel like this, and these colors complement each other fairly well. Okay, so those are the primary colors. It looks pretty horrible, but you kind of get the point. So in this one, what I want to do is select a nice color that sort of works. I'm going to go for a, sort of a blue. I might just go for a blue greenish kind of a texture. You can do these three ways as well. So that's another thing. So I'm going to try something like this. And remember, you're only just getting an idea of your colors here. You're not trying to be super awesome. So that's one way of doing it. You can also use white and black to sort of just, I don't know, fill in the colors. Essentially, color theory allows you to play around with the science of how colors affect the emotion of a scene. There's a lot to go through that. Well, we're not going to go through that, but essentially I'm just going to stick with one person of color. Now for me, I may actually try something a little bit different. I might try these three colors, because I think it's for my Hazel character. I want her to be fairly muted in terms of the color scheme. I mean, the backstory of her is that she's more of a dancer, so to speak, so I'm kind of liking that color scheme right there. So another way we can also try is the, what was it called? The something that looks a little bit like this, like a triangle. And this is kind of what I used for the Marcos character. If I just spin this around, that's kind of what the color scheme that I went for. Now, you don't necessarily need to do this in Photoshop, guys. The reason why I'm doing this is just so that I can demonstrate or show you guys what I mean. So you can see the colors right here closely resembles this one. Okay, but for Hazel, we're gonna go for this one. Now, normally I have a concept art to go with this, but because Hazel is actually a generated character, I don't actually have concept art. So ideally you want concept art with colors or some kind of rough painting on top so that you can use it as a general reference. But in my case, I'm not too worried about that because again, this is just for demonstration purposes, and I'm pretty happy to stick with something like this. So what I'm toning in now is just the skin color, or the fur color, so to speak. So just mixing and matching the colors until I get something that I like. I'm just color picking it, trying to find an ideal color resolution. Well, not resolution, sorry, I don't know what we're talking about. Okay, so that's the color scheme we're going to go for. Okay, normally over time when you get more experience, you'll be able to do all this in your head pretty much instantly. Like I said, I'm only putting this in Photoshop just so that I can get a point across. Alright, so the workflow of creating your texture is that we need to block in our colors first. Okay, and remember, you want to save this PSD quite often. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to go Maya very quickly. And in here, I have the texture applied to Hazel. So I'm going to expand those nodes and just apply that diffuse or that PSD file so that I can very quickly update and access it. Now, unfortunately, Maya doesn't update or reload textures automatically. You have to do it manually. But that's a small, that's a small problem or small inconvenience. You don't really need to worry too much about that. So that's our texture map right there. You can see we've got some slices, but most of the seams are hidden around the back, so it's kind of working quite well. All right, let's do some texturing. And I'm going to begin with the diffuse color. So let's start putting in or blocking in some of the flesh or some of the skin tones. I'm going to use my rectangle tool. And it's a very useful thing I've kind of done with my template right here, is because I don't want to spend too much time, I don't want to spend too much time messing around with all the settings until I get something that's right. So I'm just blocking these colors very quickly. Yep, color pick and fill, just tidy that up a little bit. So for the sleeves, this is where you can get into a little bit of trouble, especially if you don't have concept art. So for the sleeves, I'm going to go for a very light gray, maybe even darker than that. I'll just stick with something fairly dark. torso-wise. Remember, you've got that small, tiny segment where the shirt is supposed to come through. Again, what I'm doing is just, you know, using my mental, making mental notes as I create the UV maps. So for the torso, which is the, what do you call, shirt, or jacket, or whatever it is, I don't even know what it is. Okay, and so for the legs, let's go for something gray. I may select this top segment. And I may make this actually very white. Maybe not as white as that. Alright. So all the colors are blocked out. Now you can see it's quite fairly appealing. It sort of works. So let's go back to Maya and take a look at the texture. Let's reload and give it a few seconds. It is a bit inconvenient in Maya that you can't reload, but you know, what can you do? Okay, I forgot that segment right there. I'm just going to quickly fill that in. Now you may be wondering, you know, how long does it take for people to get good, and how do you become a professional at this stuff? Well, most of the time, it's as everyone knows, it's all about practice. And I have said this in previous tutorials that practice can, you know, the only way you can really practice is by repetition. And unfortunately, repetition gets very boring over time, which is one reason why you need to make sure the project or the character that you're creating is very appealing for you or very fun for you to make. Otherwise, you're going to struggle a lot in terms of staying motivated. Okay, save that out. Let's take a look. Reload. Okay, character looks great. Now we're going to add a few extra features, but we're going to keep that as a minor thing later. Okay, let's go back to Photoshop. All right, let's create a new layer. I'm going to call this the eye, because the eye is the simplest part to texture, and we're not going to look up any textures online. We're just going to create the eye manually. So I've laid this out. This is actually just going to be the white segment of the eyes. Oops. I'm going to turn off my feather there, it's a little bit frustrating. So what I'm doing is going to marquee select a circle. Now, I don't want to go all the way out, I want some kind of definition or some kind of handle on the end there. So pressing M, I'm going to feather and maybe 3 pixels. The reason being is because the iris or the eye that you're trying to create is not a hard edge. Okay, you need some kind of small gradient on the end there. Alright, now with that, I'm going to do that again. But this time I'm going to minus or subtract from that segment and just grab the inside just to help me paint, okay, so that I can just start painting a little bit like this. Now, the first thing we want to do is just establish what eye color we want for her. Hazel, I'm just going to start with a simple brown. And if you want to change the hue, you can do that later. So with a very noisy or chalky brush, kind of looks like this. Okay, you don't necessarily have to use it. You can use like another brush or make your own. I'm just going to very roughly put in some definition here. Now remember that the light, I want it to come down from the top left direction. You can choose, you can, you know, come from the top right. If that's the case, then you would have to paint this way. So coming from the top left, I'm going to just give more definition to the bottom right. Okay, once you have that down, then you can shrink your brush and start adding some smaller details. Okay, so making irises on eyes so easy. People struggle to find good eye textures, but really you can just paint it all in. It's shouldn't be too difficult. So when it gets to this segment here, because it's away from the light, I'm just going to make it very faint. And then shrink the brush even more. I might choose an orange color, or even a lighter color than that, and just start streaking a little bit of an extra color depth right there. I might get rid of that mask this time. It's okay if I'm actually going through the pupil. I'm doing that deliberately because I want to mix this using the smudge tool. That's the eye. Get rid of this UV, it's really annoying. And let's go to the smudge tool. Just start painting a little bit like this. Now you want to get away, keep that away from the circle as much as you can. I think I messed that up. I'm just going to undo everything there because it's disgusting. Nope, I screwed it up. I've lost my undos. That's alright. So we have the eye texture looking great. I'm just pushing those edges in. And then shrinking my brush even more and just giving those small, tiny, I don't even know what you call these things. It's a cool looking eyeball. Oops, I think I painted outside. So let's do this fairly quickly and move on to the next bit. I'm not gonna spend too much time, guys. I'm trying to make everything look absolutely perfect. That's not what I'm trying to do here. In this tutorial, all I want to do is get the point across. So, like, apologies if you think the final product isn't looking as great as it should be, or I'm overselling it. That's totally okay. What I want you to get from this is just a general idea of all the principles that I'm going to cover here, because the principles will translate to anything you do or any software that you want to utilize. Alright, I'm happy with the eyeball. I'm already sick of seeing that thing. It's actually quite creepy. So let's grab this. Grab and duplicate. Copy and paste. It's so simple. Alright, so that's our eye. I'm going to save this out. If you look in the distance, it's actually quite realistic, but look at it up close and you'll probably agree with me that it looks quite horrible. So those are our eyes completely done. Oops, let's go back here. Let's take a look at our UV map. Let's see what else we can do right here. Alright, now remember, we're not using textures, okay? We're not using textures yet. We'll get to that point in just a minute. I might actually get rid of that eye there. I'm going to create another layer, and remember, we're still on the base color. We're only blocking things in. It is very tempting when you're starting off to start adding lots of detail, and aside from, like, with the exception of the eyeball right there, you don't want to do that because adding too much detail too quickly makes things very difficult for you. All right, so with this, now this what's going through my head right now is the general anatomy or general shading of mice. So on the belly, what they will normally have is a fairly light color, okay, that contrasts from the rest of the character itself. Again, this is dependent on what style you want to go for, but I'm just going to go for this fairly generic shading. So let's quickly paint those shades in. And I promise you guys, when you're learning how to texture stuff like this, it's actually not as difficult as you may think. All you really need to do is just understand what a character should look like, and you'll be able to adjust your adjust your strategy of tackling the texturing problem quite simply. So you'll sort of get a feel of this as you go and as you practice. So with that, that's what I'm adding over there. Now remember, these are hands and feet, so for the hands, I'm going to add a small muted color on the end of the fingertips. Okay, because you don't want a flat color, guys. You want some kind of definition. And just be aware of the seams on the edge of those fingers there. Okay, so it's very, very roughly blocking things in. You can spend more time on this if you want. It's completely up to you. That's totally fine. But I'm not going to do that. I just want to get this done as quickly as possible for the sake of this tutorial. So just blocking these edges in. Again, it takes a little bit of experience, but you'll get it over time. All right, these other pieces right here. This is the ear. Again, this is the interior part of the ear. This is the exterior part of the ear. So I'm going to save this out. Oops, save this out right now. Let's go back to Maya. Again, reload. You can see we've got... Okay, so we've got that shading right there. I know it doesn't look great at this point, that's okay. Don't worry about it. But you can see this is where the ears are going. So the arrow is pointing down towards the inside of an ear. So what I want to do is just very quickly... Firstly, I want to get rid of that arrow that I've done there already. And just start painting in some of the shades that make up this earlobe. I'm trying not to get to the edge because I want the seam to be fairly seamless. Okay, so we've got great readability on that ear right there. We're going to add some extra colors to this because it's looking very flat and we don't want flat. We want this to be fairly nice or fairly in depth. I'm going to go for a color right here. Just color pick maybe something a little bit more orangey. And I'm going to add a pink on top. Okay, and also keeping in mind that the pink is going to represent the blood, because on parts of your skin there's actually less or more definition of blood, so you want to bring that in. So I'm just shading some indentations here, again not trying to be super perfect, just enough to get the point across. Your audience isn't going to look at every pixel, guys, most of the time. So if you have a good story for your animation, that will always sell it better than your awesome texturing, because quite frankly nobody cares about texturing. I'm just kidding, that's not true. I care. Or editors or digital artists like you will care. You'll probably be seeing every little imperfection on any animation that you create, and that's totally fine. But remember, your audience is usually people who, you know, won't really notice these things, so just enough to sell the point is really all that you really need. Alright, let's add some pink here. And I'm going to create a new layer, and this time I'm going to turn this to an overlay. The reason being because I want my overlay to sort of just give it a nicer effect. I'm trying to find a color that sort of works. So red is quite nice, it's a bit too harsh. Yeah, that'll be fine. Again, this is just to bring the effect of blood or subsurface scattering coming from the light, but this is only for the diffuse, okay? Real subsurface scattering to make it look really nice will come directly from the lighting in your 3D scene, and I'll show you how to do that very shortly. So that's our blocking. Next thing we're going to do is move on to the nose. And I'm going to select a color. I'm just trying to figure out which color I want to go for. So I'm going to call this base 2 layer. I'm naming all my layers as I go, guys, because I don't want to lose track of stuff, so yeah. And it doesn't take long, it takes seconds, literally seconds, and it will save you a lot of heartache, especially if your project gets more complex. So this is the color that I'm trying to go for. I'm just trying to find a color that will work. So the nose, for in terms of the nose, I want it to be red. I've tried black noses on mice before and it really doesn't work, so. But with that same color, I'm also going to color the gums. So what you see here are the gums that I'm coloring in. Just block it in. Later on, guys, you can clean the UVs up. So just quickly putting these colors in. You can see how fast you can get these general colors working for your 3D scene just by blocking. So you don't have to worry about texturing or making things look great with normal mapping, because that stuff is actually very fast. Okay, next thing I want to do is the teeth. And the teeth, I'm going to select a dull gray. I'm not using white. You don't want to use white because you want definition to come from the models itself. And it's a general rule of thumb that you never use white for anything, not even in video editing, not even in filming, unless that's actually what you want, but white tends to be a nasty, nasty enemy of the media world. Alright, so that blocking is looking great. I'm going to darken these eyes. Just add a little bit of darkness. Because this is an eyeshadow, you want the eye to pop out. So you want a slight... I'm going to change this brush. You want a slight darkness or slight shade to the eyes itself. Not too much, because this is a female character. Okay, so that's the inside right there. Okay, so far it's looking quite nice. Alright, next thing I want to do is move on to the pants right here. These will be track pants. And I'm going to get a darker shade or darker color. Now again, I'm not trying to be perfect. I just want to get a general shading down there because I don't want this texture to be completely flat. I want some kind of very gentle shading on the inside or gradient of something. So that's the inside of the track pants right there. You can go ahead and make any very, very subtle little details like so. Make it less subtle. I'm just erasing some of that because it's a bit too harsh. Alright, so those are the pants right there. Okay, so for the vest or the shirt, I'm going to add more shading, just a little bit of darker shading. Now this is actually a seam right here, so I'm not actually going to touch that. I just want to add some shading to the underarms right here, okay, just to simulate some of that ambient occlusion. You also put it on the top there. This helps just bring the texture out on segments where there's different materials. It's just a nice little trick you can do, guys, to bring this out. That's horrible. So very gently roughing that ambient occlusion in. Yes, it's not perfect. It's not amazing. It's not professional level, but it will get the point across. Okay, so next thing, we're going to use a dark gray. And again, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to select this segment and go back to my base 2 and just paint in some ambient occlusion there as well. This time I'll probably make it a little bit darker because I want it to be quite harsh. For that, I can also use the blur tool. Blur that out a little bit, maybe even the smudge tool. No, that's the burn tool. smudge tool. Sorry guys, I do make mistakes. Just softening that out a little bit. Great. And up here, I'm going to do the same. Grab some of that gray, just color pick that gray. Okay, so this is the inside of the mesh. It's the outside, or the also known as the seam. I'm going to add a little bit of ambient occlusion. Okay. I'm going to do the same for this one. Don't worry, guys, if your textures aren't looking great or your end product doesn't look great on the first round. Especially if you're learning, it happens to everyone. It's simply the fact that, you know, you don't have the muscle memory yet. So again, the only way you can get muscle memory is by practicing. And the only way by practicing, especially on a repetitive principle, is by doing it is by doing something really fun, because that helps you stay motivated. So that's our character right there. It's looking quite great. Just looking quite nice. We're actually going to add some brows. I actually forgot to add the brows. I'm just going to quickly do that. So right here, the brows, color pick that thing, and then just put the brows like so. I want it to be fairly subtle. I don't want it to be too harsh. All right, let's quickly save that, and then we'll move on to the next stage. So you can see, even though we've just been blocking this stuff, it's looking quite nice so far. And I think the brow's a bit wonky, that's a bit strange. But we didn't have to put too much effort. We've been blocking things out. Like I said, it's very tempting when you're starting off to add lots of detail, but you want to avoid that as much as possible, because adding detail is actually fairly simple. It's not as hard as people may think. Just erasing some of that out. Save it one more time. There we go. Okay, so avoid adding too much detail to anything, really. All right, it's just looking great. Now we're going to start texturing, adding all the nice little textures, all right? So what we have to do is head over to cgtextures.com. I'm just going on my second screen right here so I can load this thing up. cgtextures.com, we're going to grab some textures. They got a massive library. If you haven't got an account with this, you'll have to sign up, but it's free. It's completely free, and they give you about 16 megabytes worth of download quota every day. So go ahead to cgtextures.com. It's pretty much your one-stop shop if you want to grab some textures. So essentially what I want to do is grab some fabric textures. I'm not going to download these guys, I've already downloaded them, but if you go to the fabric textures, you can go ahead and, you know, have a look at, see what you actually need. There's also jeans, which we will, actually no, I don't think I want to look at jeans, but you can give that a try as well. But the one thing that I do want to do is grab some cloth images. Or that you want to do is to grab some cloth images like this. Okay, and I'm going to show you in just a minute why. So go to cgtextures.com, make sure you have that bookmarked in your web browser, and that way we're going to start adding some detail to our textures. So our first phase is pretty much complete. We're going to move to our second phase. So that's our base color right there. I'm going to create another folder and call this texture overlay. Now first thing I want to do is grab some cloth textures. I'm just going to drag and drop it in here. Actually minimize that as well, because I don't need to see that anymore. So cloth textures like this, we're going to create the cloth effect on our shirt and pants and sleeves. So this is more or less for use on our clothing textures or clothing material. Okay, so with this isolated, I'm just gonna shrink this down, and this is the most important thing. You don't want this to be red. I'm going to turn the hue down all the way, and let's turn this overlay on. This is where we can start to have some fun, because what we want to do is get that value into our scene, sorry, into our texture. Let's start with the pants first, and I'll show you how quickly we can do this. Now, the fastest way of doing this is by working on one side first, and then once you have that done, you start working on the other side. And also be wary of your seams. So I'm going to work from the bottom up. So I'm going to just copy that. I just held Alt and then click drag to the texture. Okay, that just duplicates it automatically. So what I've got here, we're going to be stitching these photos together, so make good use of the eraser tool. Just bring this up, and I'm just going to use a very light or rough thing right here. just cover some of those unwanted aspects up. Yeah, like so. May not, don't actually want that one, doesn't look great. Okay, oops. So I'm gonna grab that texture again. I'm gonna rotate, Control T to rotate, guys. Make use of Photoshop shortcuts because they're very, it's just much faster to work this way. I'm gonna shrink this a lot. We'll shrink it substantially, just press Enter to lock that down. I'm going to turn that UV down as well. It's a bit harsh. Just lock it. I apologize if I'm going too fast, guys. Like I said before, I'm only trying to get the point across. You'll sort of get the point. In my experience, I don't like watching tutorials for a very long period of time, and because I'm doing all this in real time, I just don't want to spend too much time blabbering on and showing you all the small things. I'm just going to go as fast as possible. But hey, I can slow down if you want me to. But it's more for your convenience that I'm just doing this really quickly. Okay, rotate. So I duplicated and rotated it. So that knee right there, I'm going to ignore. And just erase some other aspects here. Okay, so all this outside stuff I don't really need. I'll just leave that there. I just want the inside. So this is a track pants that we're doing. Duplicate. We'll better zoom out and just get a nicer view of that. And for this one, I'm going to just make it really large. I want to get rid of those seams on that side there. Oops. I do want to leave some textures around. But remember, I'm not looking at anything outside here, guys. I'm just looking at inside my UV. So if you're working, you're having a little bit of trouble trying to keep up, that's okay. So just get rid of all those unwanted stuff. It's amazing what you can do in Photoshop, guys. You can do pretty much anything in Photoshop. So that's our value. Okay, going hyperspeed now. Just painting out anything that's a little bit too dark and equalizing it, and then we'll clean it up once we've locked this off. Okay, so that's our texture right there, and with all this, I'm going to select all these layers and just go Control E and switch this back to overlay. Oops, CS6, it's torturing me sometimes. Okay, now with that, I'm going to use the polygon mask tool and just select the border edges of that UV segment. What I'm doing here is just tidying this up, guys. Selecting all the outside, just make sure we have a nice clean project to work with. And with that, press M, right click and select inverse, and just delete. So we have our value system right there. Now it's really, really horrible because we've missed some small aspects of that. So I'm going to hide that. Ideally, you want to spend more time on this, guys, so that you get a nice feel of your project. Alright, that's good enough for me. It's a little bit messy, you can see some of the cuts there, but you kind of get the point. I'm going to tidy this up a little bit later. So what I want to do now is duplicate. So hold Alt, click, or you can just go right click and then duplicate layer. Once I've duplicated, I'm going to flip this. So Control T, and then I'm going to go width -100% and just move this into position. All right, let's save this out and let's see what this looks like in our 3D scene. This could go really nice or really horribly. So it's quite nice. We've got some definition of the trousers. Again, this is not totally realistic. What you want to do is spend a lot of time just studying cloth and everything, and then, you know, spend more time trying to get those maps right. Professional texture artists will spend, you know, sometimes days or weeks working on textures sometimes, depending on, you know, the complexity of their project. Alright, same deal with the rest of this. I'm going to time-lapse this segment because it's going to get really boring, but the principle is exactly the same. What we want to do is grab the cloth texture, like you see right here, paste it. First, we've got to get rid of all that white. So I'm going to E and just delete all that. Make sure again you want this to be black and white. Okay. And then we'll start compositing this on top of our scene. So don't forget to use overlay or even soft light. We can adjust those contrasts later. And the idea here is all we really want to do is just get some values in on our cloth. All right, guys, see you in just a bit. Okay, so we've got this general feel of our texture down. We'll add more a little bit later. But the reason why we do this first is so that we can create the normal maps. I'm just going to reload this texture again, just to see an overall feel. We'll get an overall idea of what it looks like. I should save that, actually. So just reload. So it's looking quite readable, okay? You can see, even though the textures are very subtle, it does bring out a lot on our character. So don't underestimate even the smallest, most subtle things like this. So the character is looking quite nice now. We're going to move on to the fur. So with this texture overlay done for the moment, I'm going to create a new folder and call it fur. And as you guess it, we're going to go to cgtextures.net again and grab some. I've already got a texture, a fur texture. I downloaded it earlier. So this is our fur texture. And this can get really messy in Photoshop because unless you have fur that's fairly curvy or accurate, then it's you might be hard-pressed to get this looking right the first time. But I'll show you a quick tactic that I like to use. Alright, so we've got this fur texture in here, and all we're going to be doing is creating a photo composite of all that fur, and then we're just turning this into overlay. So you can already see the fur texture looking quite nice on our character. And we didn't have to do very much. All we really did was grab the photo and threw it on here as an overlay. So what we need to do now, okay, is with this fur texture, we're going to start creating a photo composite of everything. I'm going to start from the bottom right here. So just get a rough view or rough look on that fur. Okay, and then I'll erase it. So exact same principle as what I've done before, okay? Only this time it might be a little bit messy. I'm going to work on just one half of this character and then we'll move on to the next section. I mean, we'll just duplicate it to the other side. Okay, might even expand this a little bit more. Okay, duplicate, so hold Alt, duplicate. And I'm trying to follow the contours of this character right here. So remember, the closer you get to this the face, the finer the hairs become. So as a result, I'm going to have to sort of gradually change the inclination of that fur. And then just erase. So you add and erase. I might actually change this to a soft light. Okay, because I feel it just works a little bit better for what I'm after. I'll just resize this fur. Make sure I get every aspect of that correct. So you've got to be careful to delete the lines. You're going to find seams in there. And if you have seams like this line right here, it's going to cause some problems when it comes to the normal mapping stage. Oops, I'm erasing the wrong thing right there. So I'm going to get rid of those seams. It's as simple as this can ever be. Texturing is not so hard, is it now? No, it can be really fun. It can be ridiculously simple or ridiculously complicated. But that completely depends on your character. Okay, so I'm going to copy and paste another one. We'll duplicate, actually. Just shrink this. Because I'm getting to the face now, and the hairs are going to get much finer. And as a result, just switching to my mouse at this point, I'm just trying to give this a slight inclination, you know, gradual inclination. Because this fur is very straight, I'll have to sort of use several passes of that fur to get it right. Okay, and as always, just erase. Bottom one here, get rid of those seams. I mean, the fun thing about creating your character is that once you get all these principles down, once you get it sitting in your brain, you don't have to come back to it constantly. You can pretty much, you know, just go ahead and, you know, listen to music and start working by yourself with no problems whatsoever. Problems generally arise when you're not sure. You might lose motivation if you're not sure what to do. I can't find that segment. Where is it? The seam right there is annoying, right there. There you are. So getting better at your art shouldn't be too hard. It's usually difficult because people don't know what to do or they just freak out. But again, if you stick with it, you'll find that these principles will live in your brain pretty much the rest of your life. So if that's anything, any consolation, it really is just a once-off thing when you're learning tutorials. Of course, depending on your learning ability and productivity, or how much effort or time you've put into it, that will obviously depend. So I've got a nice mouse texture right here. Wow, CS6 is very strange. It's not treating me nicely that CS3 used to. Okay, so copy, paste. Okay, and just erase segments of that fur. I'm just trying to find a segment of fur that I haven't used yet. Just gonna pull that up there. Just erase that line. You can certainly use Mudbox guys or ZBrush if you want to texture a little bit more interactively. I mean, if that's the case, then no problem whatsoever. You are definitely welcome to do so. So once all that is done, I'm going to just merge them all together into one layer, just so that I've got a nice clean slate to you know, work with. And with this, I'm just going to duplicate maybe some of those lines over there. Just want to be really careful of some of my texture patterns, because it is a little bit going to mess up my thing quite a lot. Okay, so we've got rid of that annoying seam. So we've got nice subtle shading of that fur right there. So I've merged it again. I'm just going to soft light that. You can also play around with some of the composite settings. Linear light might give you more realism right here. Of course, I don't really like that. I just want this to be very subtle because I'm trying to be stylized. Again, completely up to you what you want to do. Feel free to experiment. So we've got that on one side of our character. Oops, soft light. And now what I'm going to do is duplicate this and just push it onto the other side. So width minus 100%, and just do it like so. Okay. Just press enter, and then I'm going to clean up everything, and then we'll move on to the next section. Almost finished, guys. Almost finished. Okay, I've got a problem right here. I can see there's a line right there. Actually, no, that's totally okay. I can get rid of that. Scaring me for a second there. Okay. All right, so that's our fur texture. Let's just save this, reload, and see what it looks like on our character. Now don't worry if the texture doesn't look absolutely great. All I want is just some definition. Most of the details are going to come from lighting and the normal map that we will create using ndo2. So that's our texture right there. Let's move on to the next section, which is going to be the... Actually, I forgot to do the back of the head. Oops. The back of the head right there, I'm going to put it a soft light again. I'm talking about this section, guys. Just quickly creating the mask so I can clean this up. Very useful, guys, if you learn how to utilize Photoshop shortcuts, because it just helps you work a lot faster. I know I've said that before, but people tend to forget. They'd like to do things the hard way. You may as well learn the shortcuts. It doesn't take long. It takes, you know, just a few seconds to go to the help files and just, you know, make a mental note. And it just helps you a lot in the long run. Let's do the feet and the hands. And I'm just thinking, have we missed anything? Or have missed one thing there? We're almost finished, guys. This is texturing in just about, like, I don't know, how long has it taken us? Maybe an hour? Probably not an hour, maybe more than that, guys. Okay, same deal. This is the feet. I want this to be a gradual decline of that fur into that seam. You can be more accurate than this, guys, it's okay, but that just means you have to spend more time. That's my fur right there. I'm going to duplicate and put it down here and just reverse the direction. And if you want, I actually may not do that because the seams might cause some problems. If you want, you can, you know, make a little subtle fur pattern for the feet right there. Now I'm going to do the hands. For the hands, I want this to be fairly fine. So let's do it this way. Turn this to a soft light. I don't want the fur to go to the palms or the edge of that seam. I just want it to be to stop around at the wrist joint. Okay, so the wrist joint is about there. That's what I want. But I want this to be a fairly gradual disappearance of that fur. As always, duplicate. Do not do things the hard way. Duplicate, flip, change, such. Enter. All right, last couple of things. Just this hair follicle. And because this is a hair follicle, I want this to be fairly large. So I'll do it right about there. Just get rid of the edges of that because we don't really need it. You guys don't need to see me clean this up, so you can clean it up yourself. Just make sure you get this down. And for the hair follicle, I'm going to make this very subtle. I don't want it to be too harsh. And on top of that, here's a really cool trick. For you to give more depth to the hair follicles or hair mesh, you want to just add a little bit of extra value on the end, the tip end right there. So I'm going to turn this to a overlay. So all I'm really doing is just lightening that up. I just want to lighten that edge, that tip. It's a bit too harsh. I'll just make it nice and subtle. It just helps bring or helps lift that hair follicle. So this is our texture. And I forgot to put this in the fur folder right there. Never mind. Fur 2. I think I must have accidentally pushed all that fur texture out of the original texture directory. So I'm just going to call this texture overlay again. Great. Let's turn off our UVs, save this out, and let's take a look at this one last time before we go to the normal mapping stage. So did it load? I think it loaded. I can't really tell. Oh, yes, it did load. So that's a texture right there. Sorry, that's our character. That's our character right here. It's looking quite nice. Oh dear, I actually forgot one more thing, guys. I think it's actually my fault. The hands actually extend a little bit further than that. That's because I actually deleted faces previously. So what I'm going to do is just quickly extend this. My apologies, guys, this is my fault. Extend it out a little bit like that. Going to do the same for this one. Okay, let's save this out. Reload. That's our fur right there. It's looking quite nice. Because this is a female, we don't want it to be too strange. So I'm quite happy with that. Now, of course, this doesn't look totally great. Okay, that's because we need to add lights, and then we've got to create the normal maps. So for the normal maps, we need to utilize a program called Endo2. Now, if you don't have Endo2, I'll just quickly go to the website. If you don't have Endo2, you can go to quixel.se to download a free 30-day trial. Okay, so this is basically an app that runs side by side with Photoshop. And what this will allow you to do is it will create normals based on images in your Photoshop. And the reason why you want normals is so that you can get realistic bump mapping. Okay, so go ahead and take a look at this website. It's a great, great tool. I personally use this myself for a lot of modeling. It's definitely invaluable, and it speeds up workflow a lot. So I've had to move back to Photoshop CS3. Unfortunately, Endo2 has been causing some problems in Photoshop CS6. All right, once we have this loaded, it pretty much runs besides Photoshop. So what we have to do is start creating our normals. Okay, well, now that we've got the diffuse, creating normals is really, really easy. And this is only good if you've already got your texture down correct. Okay, normally you would create like a general height map as well, but because this is a fairly simple character, we can just use this texture and create the normals with that. So the first thing I want to do is duplicate my folder, and then I'm going to Control E just to merge those layers all together, just so that we've only got this one layer right here. What you want to do is select that layer and go to Presets. And in Endo 2, you've got a bunch of presets that we're going to be using. And because we have two different kinds of materials here, we've got a fur material and we've also got some cloth material, we are going to first create the cloth material just by using the soft spectrum and then go active dock. Now this is going to take a few minutes depending on how fast your computer is, but once this is complete, we will move on to the next stage. Now that once this is complete, we have we've got you reserved UV area right here as well. We've got our texture, and what we're going to do is go to our ball right here. I'm just going to use my mouse wheel to zoom in, and then I can hold Alt and rotate this around. I can also hold the right mouse button and adjust the lighting. The purpose of this is just to see your normal maps in action, just to see what it actually looks like. Okay, so far it's looking quite nice. Now remember, keeping in mind that this is just for the cloth, so we're not creating normals for the fur just yet, because that's a little bit too harsh. So for the cloth, let's tweak some of these settings. First setting I want to tweak is the large waves. So I'm going to turn some of the large waves down. So with this, just turn it down. And it will update in this ball as you go. Oops. Let me turn that up a little bit. And it's going to take a little bit of tweaking on your part, but again, this is a very, very fast way of creating your normals. Okay, I'm going to turn some of the medium details down as well. And essentially, you want to get something that's quite clothy, so to speak. I don't know if that makes any sense whatsoever, but you kind of get the point. Okay, so looking quite nice. And assuming you're happy with all the settings that you've done, you can go ahead and just press Control E. Actually, I might just move that out of the way. So go to your normal PSD, okay? Endo 2 will create a new PSD. I'm just going to Control E to flatten that up. And then copy and paste this onto our scene right here. So just copy and paste it on top. Now what I want to do is get rid of the fur section, okay, because I don't want to include that at all. So we're just going to marquee select and just delete. The fur section, we're going to do another pass. Alright, so that's what it is. And I may make a small change right here because this is causing us a few problems. Okay, so I'm just going to black that out and Control E. Okay, and with the fur, same deal, we're going to go select that layer, presets, and this time we're going to go to wavy hair and then active dock. Alright, leave this running for a few minutes and then we'll come back straight to it. Alright, so now that that's done, let's just quickly zoom into our texture right here. Now with this, we're going to set the settings. I want to lose a lot of those large waves and bring up some of the fine hairs. So we just want the fur, not the large clumps. So tweaking these settings around will take a little bit of time, but you can experiment with this on your own project. Just bring in some of those settings down until I get something that I kind of like. Yeah, I know there's a bit of specular there, but that's fine. That's not what we're focusing on. We just want to see the hair strands. And depending on how fast your computer is, this might take a little bit of time, but as you can see, it's not too bad. Okay, so I'm quite happy with that. And the best part is you can also see the irises. Actually, I might just put it down there. You can see the irises also have a small amount of definition there as well, which is exactly what we want. All right, I'm going to, same deal as before, I think I can close Endo 2 down now. Same deal as before, I'm going to flatten all those layers and just copy and paste this into my project, into my original PSD file. And I'm going to add our cloth texture on top and just double check to make sure the UVs are laid out correctly. And it's looking quite nice, so we're pretty much ready to take this to the finish line. Now what I want to do next is just flatten these layers, of course. But I also want to export this out. So I'm going to save this as a PSD file. Sorry, not a PSD. I'm going to save as a PNG file. You don't want to save as PSD, guys. You want to utilize another format. PNGs are great, or TIFFs. I'm going to call this D for diffuse and save this out. Okay, and I'm also going to save the normal map as a PNG file, just to be consistent. Hazel N for PNG, or sorry, normal. Okay, with that saved, let's go back to Maya. I think I can close some of these unwanted windows down. So that's what we've got. We've got the normal map and our diffuse. Okay, so I'm not going to go through specular or create any ambient occlusion. We're going to leave it at that. Let's go back to our Microsoft, let's go back to our Maya, and this is Hazel once again. We're going to take a look at the texture nodes. So I've utilized this node right here. This is our texture diffuse, and I'm going to change this back to a PNG, or to the PNG texture that we saved out. So don't use the PSD if you can. I only use PSD because it's just much quicker to reload and update. So that's a PNG file now. Now this is the bump map, and it's going to be the normal map. And what we need to do is go to the bump 2D and make sure it's in tangent space normals, okay? So you don't want to use bump, you want tangent space normals. So that's our character right here. Now you can't see the bump. What you can do is go to either high quality rendering or viewport 2.0. I'm going to use viewport 2.0. This is a feature they brought in to Maya 2010, I think, or 2012, and maybe that. All right, now you can see that there are really messy seams in the back here. Okay, now for our project, I don't really care about this. I'm okay with this because I just need to make a good point. You can see our character is pretty much ready to go. I might have to fix some of those normal maps there, but that's alright, I'll leave it for the moment. But let's go ahead and start lighting our scene. Now remember, I'm using furryball. You can go ahead and use a something like mental ray. I don't actually have that loaded up, but if you want to use mental ray, make sure you have it loaded up. Just go to window, settings and preferences, and plugin manager. If you scroll all the way down, you can find the Maya to MR. Just make sure that's loaded, because by default it's usually not loaded. And then Mental Ray will allow you to play around with indirect lighting, subsurface scattering, ambient occlusion, and all that. I'm not going to go through that because it's just going to take too long. All I'm going to do is just use the furryball, okay? So furryball is a great hardware renderer, and it simulates a lot of what Mental Ray can do. It can create global illumination, it can fake some subsurface scattering. There are some limitations, of course, but overall it's a very fast renderer. It allows you to do hardware rendering at a more realistic level. So what I've done is I've created a render node, and before I go into the render node, I'm going to create some lights. So I have a previous tutorial that I've done talking about lights, so we're going to create an area light. Press 7 just so that I can see my lighting, and then I'm going to move my area light around here. Okay, sorry, I'm in viewport 2.0, so it's going to cause us some problems. Just go back to default mode and start lighting my character. Now I want my character to be key lighted, or key lit, from the top right. because I'm going to have my camera probably around at this angle. Speaking of cameras, let's go create a camera. I'm going to go create and then camera. And look through selected. Let's make sure I get an angle that I like. Another thing I also want to do is make sure my framing sort of works in terms of my resolution. We'll get to that in just a minute. But I'm going to leave the camera. So the camera's right there. I know it's a bit small, but that's alright. Now, furryball. This is great. I'll show you how furryball works. If you go to furryball, so I go to my renderer and then furryball. This will load up and then you can see what the render will look like. Okay, it doesn't look too great at the moment. That's because we're going to have to do a few things. Firstly, I want to add some subsurface scattering. So if I go back to my hypergraph, this is just the workflow for furryball, guys. If you want to use mental ray for subsurface scattering, you're going to have to create a skin or MSS skin spec node. Okay, but for furryball, we don't use that. We actually use furryball nodes. Now I'm going to go to furryball up here and just go add a new material. This will create a new node on that texture that I've applied to Hazel. And then I'm going to enable subsurface scattering. Now the problem with this is that area lights don't allow subsurface scattering. So we're going to have to create a second light. I'm going to go back to default quality rendering and then just go create a point light. I'm just going to put it roughly around the area light right there. And of course I'm going to enable shadows. Depth matte shadows. There is no ray tracing for furryball, guys. At least I don't think there is. Then I'm going to turn the shadows for the area light as well. And then we'll go back to furryball and see what it looks like. So you can see we've got some subsurface scattering coming through. But ideally what I want to do is play around with the settings until I can get more definition of that. So by itself, it's okay by itself. It's not great. Default settings can only get you so far. So what I want to do is just increase some of these settings. Now the problem is it can be very subtle, so just have a play around until you get something you like. You can see it's starting to come through now. Okay, so I'm just bringing up this softness. Just playing around these settings till I get something that sort of works. Now it is a bit tricky to see, but you can kind of get the point. So this is with subsurface scattering. You'd see, even though we've only got one light, technically we've got two lights, but even though we've got one light, you can see the SSS coming through quite nicely. So that's without, that's with it. No subsurface, with subsurface. You can see the realism already comes through with just this one setting. And we've got this applied to the rest of our body as well, which is kind of what we want. So this is how we get nice realistic lighting by using subsurface scattering. But we're not going to stop there. We're going to add more lights. Remember, this is just the key light, and I'm going to use a very classic three-point lighting system. So you have a key light, you have a rim light or backlight. And with this, I'm going to change the color to a slight orange, just to give it a nice warm color for our character right here. Let's go back to furryball and see what it looks like. Yep, so it's looking great. I'm going to shift drag it and move it until I can see more of her shoulders right there. Okay, just move it back. All I want is just rough outlines, because that makes it look really nice. Might turn that up, maybe even change the color to a slightly hotter or warmer color. Okay, so we've got that. So I've got two lights now. One other thing I also want to do is add another point light, because the subsurface is not coming through. But this will mean I have to adjust that point light accordingly. So just roughly placing it in the area of my area light. this is going to cause us some problems because it's going to be overexposed, and that's not what we want. So that's our character so far. Okay, so we're getting better leaks of light coming through. Might turn the point light into a slightly orange color. And then with my outliner, I'm going to select that area light and just dial it down, because I'm compensating a bit too much for that point light system right there. Come think of it, I might select that point light again and just turn it down once more. So there's a lot of tweaking, guys. You'll find that it's just takes a little bit of practice. Eventually you'll be able to sort of know these things automatically. Okay, so with that down, let's create one more light, and this is going to be the fill light. Oops, better move that out of the way. So the fill light generally is a little bit lower in general, not always. And the idea here is to lose that harsh silhouette outline or harsh silhouette effect. So let's go back to my furry ball, and this is our character so far. So 3-point lighting system, very useful. This one may be a blue color, maybe even a teal color, because I want to match that shirt right there. Let me mute that color down a little bit, just bring that white up. So we've got a nice lighting system on our character. Yes, that normal map is very frustrating, that's totally okay. So it's looking, our character's looking quite nice so far. Now I'm going to adjust a few settings. I want the lighting here to be a different color. So most likely a red, even an orange color. Most of these things take more or less experience. The more experience you have, the more automated you become, because you'll be able to make these, you know, mental simulations in your head on what the character is supposed to look like. Just changing that point light slightly. So there, it is a lot of tweaking, but you kind of get the idea when it comes to creating your scene or lighting a scene. So our character is looking nice. One thing I don't like is the fill light. I'm going to might actually move that up. And just adjust it. Playing around with the settings, guys, just until I get something that I like. So there we have it, that's a nice render. Now this is not where we stop, okay, because we have to bring this into After Effects and do what's called post-production. So we're going to add some glows, add some backgrounds and all that, but ideally the lighting that we have here, I'm just going to leave it as it is, and then I'm going to move on to the next step, which is the posing stage. Now posing is fairly simple. It's all about just trying to find something that's very appealing to the audience. Unfortunately, something as subjective as appeal is very difficult to be able to teach. You just have to sort of get inspiration online and then go from there. So I've taken the time to quickly fix up my material problem, the bump mapping right there. Okay, so you probably have to make sure you get that right before you start texturing, guys. Unfortunately, I missed it while I was doing because I'm in a bit of a rush, but that's fine, we've got that out of the way. We're going to move on to the posing stage. And posing will allow us to give this character a little bit of personality. For me, I've just put a rough kind of pose right here. And if you're not experienced with posing, that's totally fine. Go just head over to the internet or go on art forums and look up some pose references and just go ahead and copy. Now, first thing I want to do is establish what kind of a character this is. This is a very generic character, just a mature adult female character. I'm going to give her a very simple pose. So nothing too fancy. First thing I want to do is begin offsetting a few things. Actually, no, the first thing I want to do is establish a camera angle. So I'm going to go to my layout and two panes side by side. Let's find my camera right there and look through selected. Now the resolution I've chosen is a 1080 by 1920, so it's kind of reverse to 1080p. I've done this so that I can frame my character properly like this. So I'll leave, maybe just put her around at that angle, just as a rough starting point. And going back and forth between our perspective and camera, we're going to begin posing our character. Now, unfortunately, posing can be a bit of a pain sometimes because you will need to just sort of experiment with a few things. As I said before, if you don't have experience with posing, that's totally fine. Just go ahead and find references over the internet and utilize that as a starting point. But body language communicates a lot. So I'm going to quickly put her feet like so. I'm going to offset her feet here. Just push one of the feet back. Because nobody stands, in general, nobody stands with 2 feet symmetrically. So just offsetting it will give it a lot more, a much more organic feel. Also, I also don't want her legs to be bent, so I'm going to just do that. Alright, next thing I want to do is, the way you want to pose your character is you generally want to start from the center of mass and then move outward towards the child nodes. So I've kind of done my hips. I kind of did it a little, you know, one different way. There's no one way of doing it, guys. But that's generally a good way of going about this. Alright, next thing I want to do is just exaggerate this pose a little bit more because it's a little bit too, it's just too generic, so I might just offset. I'm looking at this camera, by the way, guys, and moving this in the perspective. I'm going to offset her hips a little bit just so that I got a nicer curve on her body on this side. That's a much more appealing feminine pose. Alright, let's quickly... Oh, we'll do the facial expressions before I finish off with that hand. So I want this character to be a fairly... I'm just going to get those layers out of the way. So I want this to be a fairly happy character. And because she is feminine, her facial expression will be much softer. I mean, if you've got skinning problems, guys, feel free to change it and adjust it. You want to do that. I've also got some, I'll have a teeth problem right here, you'll see. That's because the teeth aren't actually symmetrical when the jaw moves up. So again, this is a mistake on my part. Ideally, what you want to do is get this stuff fixed up before you start posing your character. But like I said before, the beginner tutorial, all I'm really doing is just trying to get the point across here. You guys can spend more time, but I just want to get this done as fast as possible. I've also got a gum clipping through here. That's the teeth gums. Let's just move this up so that we're not blocking anything or looking sloppy. So essentially a lot of these problems I'm just sweeping under the rug, guys. Don't tell anyone I'm cheating here. Don't tell anybody I'm being sloppy. The gums aren't actually proper over there, but that's alright. I'm not too worried about that. She looks a little bit too sad in terms of her eyebrows. I'm going to bring her other eyebrow up. And let's give her a smile. So these are my mouth controls. Okay, there's a bit of clipping again. It's a skinning problem. It's my mistake. And I'm going to fudge a lot of this. Thankfully, this is not going to be animated, at least anytime soon. And I don't really have to worry too much about that. Again, we've got more skinning problems and all that stuff, but you can see the point that I'm trying to get across here, guys. I'm getting an appealing pose. It's all about patience and taking your time, just making sure things look decent or works with the audience. Now I do know that I haven't actually created a tutorial on how to make this model. That's the reason being is because my screen capture software has been messing up, has been messing me up big time. So I've decided just to do the texturing because I have two character tutorials already in my channel. So if you want to take a look at that, you can go ahead and go through that again. Just take a look at the playlist. Take your time. It does go from concept to completion through a lot of the rigging stages. If you want to utilize what I'm doing here is called the human IK, you can go ahead and do that. It's much faster than creating your own rig, but it's also a good idea if you want to create your own rig to just go through those tutorials itself. So this is our character right here. I'd say it's fairly appealing, but I may not want her to show her teeth. I want her to be fairly feminine, a lot more even-headed, so to speak. So I'm going to hide her top teeth. I'm fudging this, guys. I'm fudging this big time. But I really want to move on to the next stage. And I'm sure you guys do too. You don't want to spend too much time watching me make all these tiny little adjustments until it's absolutely perfect, because the fact is it's not going to be absolutely perfect. Okay, one last thing I might want to do is probably lift her foot up. I may lift her foot up, so I'm going to pin the heel right here. So pin translate, I'm going to pin translate on the toe cap and just move this IK handle up. Just these small things that help bring an appeal or give an appeal to your character. Okay. There you go. This is Hazel. And I'm going to go to my furry ball. This is a hardware renderer, so I don't have to spend time waiting for that. Okay, so I'm going to lock this camera off on this particular pose. Yeah, just double checking to make sure the character looks it's working. So we're going to go ahead and play with the lights again. Again, going back and forth with my references. I can go really dark, but I don't want to do that. I want this character to be fairly... let me warm up those colors. Another thing I also want to do is actually fix her, the size of her hands right there. Just bring those colors up. And I don't know if I've got, yeah, I do have shadows, just didn't look like it had shadows for a second there. So let's, I'm just going to put it 7.3, and I might bring this backlight up a little bit more. Actually no, I'll leave that at about 8. What I want to do is increase the light of that point light. Again, what I'm trying to do is get a nice rim shade on my subject. Alrighty, now we're just about ready to fix up some light, and then we'll move on to the rendering stage. So again, I'm using furryball. Back to our lighting again. Just want to save this. And her hand is clipping in the clothing again. I'm just going to move this out slightly. Alright, so that's our very appealing character, if I do say so myself. So we're going to play around with some lights here. And don't worry about the floor, we're going to create our own floor in After Effects. The reason being is because it's just much better. I don't need to spend a lot of time trying to make everything look perfect in Maya. We can create simple things like this in post. Make sure to keep this a warm color, the light in the background there. Only because I feel it works a lot better with the colors that we have right here. Okay, so looking nice. One last thing is I'm going to add a ambient light. And if you don't know what ambient light does, it basically lights everything regardless of the light direction. So the purpose of this, what I'm doing is I'm just going to fill in this entire scene with a very small intensity, very slight intense light. This will sort of, okay, it's actually causing us some problems, I might actually just delete that. But in general, what I wanted to do is get a good read on some of those bad shadows there. I'm going to fudge this and use another area light and lose the shadows on this particular area light. I'm going to make this 0.2, and I'm going to fill her chin just underneath the chin where you can see the shadows right there. I'm just going to try and fill it up some kind of lighting. Just aiming it up, maybe playing around with some of those. So these are the really subtle things that you can include, and depending on what you want. Okay, this key light, I'm going to increase its warmth. Should just change the angle a little bit just so that we have softer lighting on the front side of a character. Okay, so what I'm going to do is apply this second texture. I'm going to remove that specular color right there. just apply the second texture onto my hair, and I'm going to add new material attributes onto this texture node. Don't worry guys if you don't know what I'm doing here, all I'm really doing is just trying to make the hair stand out or just balance the hair color a little bit with my character's head. Okay, so it's looking quite nice. One last thing I want to do is just add a bit of a what do you call that thing? Just a velvet material. And I'm trying to find where that went. Ah, here we go, velvet strength. This will help me get a bit of a rim shade. I'm going to go velvet strength. This also helps us make it look a little bit more cartoony. And with that, I'm also going to turn down my lights. Because you don't want it to blow out on the whites over there. That's one reason why I said you don't want to use whites as your textures, because they do blow out and it's very difficult to balance. Okay, so we've got a nice key light right there. I think we're ready to go. Okay, so I'm going to get rid of that floor right there, and this is going to be our character. For us to render this, you can, again, I am using furryball as a renderer. The only reason why I'm using that is because it's much faster than using mental ray and it helps me prove a point. So if you want to use something like mental ray and you're not sure how to do that, you can go ahead and take a look at some mental ray tutorials online. I will make one later down the track, but for now we're just going to work with this. So with this character right here, I'm going to change the resolution. If I go to my render settings, just head down to the height. I'm going to make this 4K, so 4000. Okay, so that's the resolution I want to render this out as. All right, render layers. Again, the principles of render layers is the same where you're using mental ray or V-ray or such. But for furryball, I'm going to create different layers to render out. So this is going to be the beauty pass, which basically means it has everything on there. With this same node, I'm going to duplicate it, and I'm going to call this the depth pass. Duplicate it again. This will be the subsurface scattering or diffuse. I am also going to have ambient occlusion. And if you want, you can also have a matte. Because we don't have any specular or reflectivity on this, we don't need any of those. So we'll work with what we've already got. So let's just go through what we have here. We've got the beauty pass, depth, subsurface scattering, ambient occlusion, and matte. Now for me to adjust this in furryball, I have to go to my renderer here and just go to ambient occlusion. Actually, I'll leave that in. And if you go to ambient occlusion node right here, just select that, go to features. Sorry, not features. If you scroll all the way down to render settings, just go to the output pass, change the output pass to ambient occlusion. Now, I don't actually have ambient occlusion enabled here, so what I want to do is go to GI settings. And just start adding some values. May go back to my AO just to check to see if it's actually on. It's not on, so that's our ambient occlusion. Because this is screen space, it's actually not very accurate. Okay, furryball is a hardware renderer. Its main perk is that it's very fast. That's why you can see me rotate around and you can see the render quality of that. But ambient occlusion may not be suitable for our character in this case because it's quite low poly. So it'll probably work if you have a higher poly character, but we're going to, this will demonstrate what ambient occlusion is. Let's go to the next one, which is the depth map. So go to my depth node, just make sure depth is on, don't think it's actually there. If I go down, same deal, I'm going to select depth. Now you can see the Z depth of my character. SSS, same deal. This will be actually the diffuse. So there's no SSS in furryball. I'm trying to find diffuse. Here you are. So diffuse, and just check to make sure it's there. So that's our horrible subsurface scattering. But that's how we're going to render that out. Let me also bump the samples to 3. And of course the mat is not necessary in this case, because furryball kind of renders it out with an alpha channel already, but let's do that anyway. So that's our mat. Again, change the samples to 3 just to get the maximum amount. So what we have is beauty pass, we have a depth pass, which again I have to increase to 3 samples, and we've got a subsurface scattering right here. And what we're going to do is composite this in After Effects and make this look awesome. So what we're going to do is go to output, to my output settings, and I want my beauty, depth, matte, and subsurface. And remember all the settings in terms of resolution is going to come from your Maya render settings. And after this, I'll just make sure everything's highlighted, and I am going to render camera 1, which is what we're looking at here. And let's bring this into After Effects and finish this tutorial off. Alrighty, let's take this to the finish line, shall we? So in After Effects here, I'm going to drag my images just into my comp. And this is my beauty character, so I'm just going to drag it and create a new comp. So the renders come out quite nicely. So some of the textures may not look as great as they should be, but that's fine. So what we want to do now is start compositing all of these images together. Now you may be wondering why I've only got 4 here, but that's because I just want to keep this tutorial simple. So the more layers that you have, for example, if you have specular, you can go ahead and control the curves of the specular or change the hue. In my case, I've got some subsurface scattering just ready to go, and ideally what I'm going to do is do a soft light composite. May not actually work, sorry, a lighten. Let's try a lighten, wherever that may be, right here. So that just gives that character a little bit of a extra boost in its on the colors. So with the curves, I'm going to play around with the subsurface scattering. Again, see, this is what you can do to control all these tiny little things in post. This is why it's called post-production, because you do it after you've done all the rendering. So what I'm going to do is just change some of the lighting and bring up the greens, sorry, just bring up the oranges, the orange appearance of that. So what I'm trying to achieve here is a good balance of my character colors. Ideally, you want to get it as close as possible in your 3D scene before you bring it in here. Otherwise, you're going to have a hard time fixing up all these little things. But that's pretty much it. We don't need to do any more on this character. So with this, I'm going to name this comp a Hazel comp. And I'm going to create a new composition. This time I'm going to make it larger, just slightly larger than the Hazel comp. I've just punched in a value there. I don't really care. I'm going to call this master, or Hazel master. And make sure you tidy up your project files as you go, especially when it gets more complex. So with the Hazel comp, I'm just going to drag that in, and we're going to start creating the background. So the first thing I want to do is save this. So save it under my media right here. So that's her pose. And what we can do to sort of fudge the floor and background, remember this is a still image, you don't want to do this with an animation unless you have it correctly tracked. But because this is an image, where we're going to have a much easier time working on this. So I'm going to go through my texture library. You can't really see it. I'm just going to try and grab a texture that I've utilized before. So from cgtextures.com, I've grabbed a bronze texture or a copper texture like this. You can choose whatever texture you want, guys. You don't have to do what I'm doing. What I'm going to do is just turn this into a 3D layer and rotate it 90 degrees. Oops. Just move it down to a feet. Another neat little trick you can do is just offset that slightly. Okay, so that's what she's going to be standing on. And what we're going to do is use the ellipse tool and just draw in a circle, because this is going to be the vignette. Now remember, the light is coming from this direction, the top right. So I want to extend the light kind of that way. And with this mask, let's go press MM and just soften those edges. All right, I'm going to do the same with the background. I'm going to drag the background of that copper right there and just put it behind her. We're going to, again, draw a mask around the character. It doesn't necessarily have to be a circle. You can offset some of the settings just to make things a little bit more interesting. Same deal, feather that mask out. Okay, so we've got some a nice base for those textures right there. The next thing I want to do is start color balancing a few things. I may also create a black. And the purpose of this black is just to mask some areas that may leak through. This is more just to make sure my scene is nice and tight. So I'm going to draw a mask and just feather that out as well. Just so that we don't see any seams on the right there. I don't want the audience to know that the floor is touching the wall over there. So with this bronze copper, let's apply a curve. I'm going to crush the blacks and bring up the whites, just to give it a lot more contrast. And remember, I'm trying to match that light color, so with this, let's play with the reds a little bit. Maybe up the greens and pull the blues down ever so slightly. You can adjust this as you go. I'll tweak this after I've completed this tutorial. I'm going to apply the same to the back. But for the back, I may want to change the theme or the colors. So I want to match her vest right there. So again, bring the blacks down. I may also bring some of the whites up just slightly. And let's play around with the blues, greens, and reds. So I'm going to pull the blues up. Bring the reds down. Maybe bring the greens up as well. Okay, so we've got something that looks quite nice. I'm also going to add a hue, just the hue modifier. Bring that saturation down so we have a much stronger color. And play around with these settings again, just until I get something that I like. So that's a quite appealing color scheme. Also expand it up. Maybe bring that mask up slightly. Over time, you guys will be able to get a hang of all these principles. They'll live in your head, so you don't need to worry about being absolutely perfect the first time you start off. Okay, so that's our background. It's looking really, really nice. Next thing I want to do is add a bit of ambient occlusion on the feet. Again, we're going to fudge this. This is just a still image, no big deal. And with the bronze copper on the floor, which should be down there, Okay, I'm going to turn this black matte into a 3D layer and just copy the orientation settings. So copy and paste, and then the position as well. So copy, paste. Actually bring that up just that we can see that layer right there. So this is my ambient occlusion fake. We're going to draw a mask around the bottom of her feet, and just keeping in mind that you want to sort of follow the imaginary contours of that feet in the background there. I'm going to do the same over here. This time I want to add a little bit in that background or behind that foot. Simple matter of just changing the color, sorry, the feather. And with that, let's turn this to an overlay. I'm going to duplicate this and then turn this to a multiply. So for the overlay, I may increase that slightly, just that I got more definition of that feet. Of that foot, sorry. Just expand that a little bit. Now, also I need to add some fake ambient occlusion to the feet as well, which I will do. Let's go to the hazel. Just duplicate that and add a curve. And I'm going to bring this down, all the way down. Now, as you imagine, what we're going to do is just mask this just around on the foot right there, like so. Feather this out so we've got a nice fake mask. I'm going to do the same for this one. Do the same, just feather that out so that we can see a nice connection between those, the feet on the bottom right there. For the multiplied, I might change this back to normal. Decrease that feather and increase the, just expand that mask a little bit. Lose that harsh outline there. Just play with the settings. Okay, feet's looking quite nice. We're going to add a just duplicate that same black layer, and I'm going to add a very small fake shadow there as well. So what I'm going to do is just do a circle like so, just bring this under her foot. Let me expand this slightly. So this is just a fake shadow, guys. There's nothing special or weird about it. I'm going to turn this to an overlay. And let's bring that feather up a lot. And then maybe bring that down. You may also want to bring that opacity down as well, because it's a bit too harsh. Just so that we crush the colors a little bit. Now, ideally, what I want to do is also simulate some blue, because this is very, very red on the bottom. So what I'm going to do is just select a blue and see if I can get a good balance of that color. It's not really working, so I think we'll leave it as it is. All right. Couple things. I'm also going to duplicate this bottom floor right here. So duplicate, and we'll turn this to an add. Now what I want to do is also turn the hue or the saturation down a lot, because I just want to lighten the floor up. Like so. Around there, a bit more gradient to sort of help out the lighting. So mess around with the lighting a little bit until we get something that we like. So it's quite appealing right now, our character. One last thing I may also want to add is, you've noticed I also have a depth map right here. I don't feel as though I need this, mainly because I'm pretty happy with that, and because of the mat, we've already got an alpha channel on the PNGs that we have there, so we don't really need a mat. But essentially what you want to do with the mat is you just add it on top of your layer and then turn on Luma mat, okay? And that's how you mask your character out. So I'm going to try one more small thing, a couple of small things. I'm going to duplicate that back over there and just turn on add. Again, what I'm trying to do is add a little bit more definition or depth to the texture in the back, otherwise it's just a flat texture. Oops. So with that, selecting that, just expand the mask a little bit. I'm going to turn that saturation down and reset some of these settings. So what I want to do is give that a little bit of a red, slightly red hue, or maybe even orange hue. This just helps bring that character out a little bit more. Again, also again gives depth to the texture itself, that you're not stuck with just one single color. All right, looking really, really nice. Now I'm going to bring my subsurface scattering again, and we're going to put this on top of the character, just in this particular comp. So I'm going to just drag and drop it in here. And you can see we've got that. Now with this, what I want to do is turn this to an add. And yes, it's blowing it out. I also want to turn the glow, or the bit rate, bits per channel, to 32 float. The reason being is because I want to add a glow. And this glow will help just decorate our character even further. When in doubt, add glow. So with this, what I want to do is, I may go back to my hazel comp and disable that here. Just see what it looks like if we go back to our master comp. I may turn this to a screen, because like I said, it's blowing out some of those edges. Oops, I am messing around with the wrong thing. Let's try this again. So screen. There you go, much softer lighting method. I may do two passes of this glow. So the first pass will allow us to get nice soft subsurface values, which I think is looking much nicer than what we had previously. I'm going to add curves once more. With these decisions, you sort of need to make on the fly. Sometimes something may work in your head, but it might not work on paper. And that's the idea of compositing. You know, check it out, guess and check, trial and error to see what works, see what doesn't. And if it doesn't work, then it's a good idea to go ahead and change it. And it's okay, you don't have to be perfect the first time around. Quite often you'll be just exploring something, testing the waters and trying to find something that works. So with this glow, I just want to get the very edge of that glow. And I don't want too much black. Sorry, I don't want too much light on that. I want to get that as black as I can. Let me also bring that hue down, switch the curve so that it's underneath the hue. Now with this, I'm going to change the threshold. Just bring that threshold up. And we have a nice glow on our character. So one last thing. Let's create an adjustment layer on top. What we're going to do is we're going to grade this overall appearance in one go. Let's add a curve to our adjustment layer. I've actually colored it orange so that it's kind of just a habit of mine. And let's play around with these settings. What I like to do is leave the blacks and highs, sorry, the blacks and whites as, you know, as they are, and just bring up some of the mids ever so slightly, but you can, you know, have a little bit of fun and play around with this. I might actually just bring the whites up, crush the blacks, bring the whites. Okay, with that I'm also going to pull the reds and bring the reds up on the high end so that we have a nice strong character appearance right here. So that's our character. I'm going to add a few tiny little adjustments just for taste. I'm trying to find that. I'm going to duplicate this bottom floor shadow right here. Turn this to normal. What I want to do is create a... Oh wow, that actually works. I might leave that there. But what I want to do is create a vignette here, because I'm going to add this to my YouTube channel. It's going to look awesome. Well, that's my personal opinion. Everyone has their own personal opinion. Alright, and with that, I'm going to expand that mask about that size and turn this to a subtract, just so that we get the edges of that rim. Oops. Play around with the feather. Might expand that because a mask is maxing out at this point. And just bring some of those blacks in. So it's been a wonderful little 3D journey so far. You can see the texturing doesn't take too long. Once you know what to do, it is all it really is just you, you know, hammering away at a lot of the basic laundry list stuff. So where, you know, once we get something looking nice and we know what to do, everything is just muscle memory. So there you have it, guys. This is Hazel, a female mouse character. Hope you're enjoying these tutorials. If you like this content, please subscribe, and I will start going through more tutorials over time. We're going to get into the more advanced stuff, so tell your friends about this stuff if they're not sure how to do 3D. If you have any requests, as always, please let me know. I'll get back to you through tutorials, and definitely happy to help out people who need that. So here you go, guys. Hope you're enjoying this. I'll see you guys in the next tutorial.